The book of 1 Corinthians, chapter number 9. Beginning verse number 24.
Know ye not
that they which run in a race run all.
But one receiveth the prize.
So run.
That you may obtain. And every man that striveth for the mastery,
yes,
is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown. But we an incorruptible. I therefore so run. Not as uncertainly. So fight I. Not as one that beateth the air. But I keep under my body. And bring it into subjection. Lest that by any means. When I have preached to others. I myself shall be a castaway.
Thank you. I want to talk this morning about spiritual championship. Get that, please. You notice here, the apostle is suggesting that there are those who satisfy themselves with the minimum. And he said that that lethargic attitude will not fit in the kingdom. You follow? So he said, listen, they that strive for the masters. In other words, every saint of God should be striving to maximize his potential. That's what brought the apostasy. People satisfy themselves with just being a part of it. But they don't seem to sense what the goal is. Don't seem to have a definite objective. And the church dies. And you die.
Yes.
Let me tell you, you know, your quest is what keeps you alive.
Yes.
And this, even Paul, when he was nearing the end, he was still striving, that I may know him. You know him as much as anybody on earth, Paul's with me, but there's another little area here. There is another little degree.
Yes, sir.
You follow me? And now, you know, sometimes we get a little spoonful of glory and think we own heaven and just walk around, and strut our shoulders and do it. But that is, when you get that attitude, you're headed for downfall.
Lord.
Congregationally, individually, however. You follow me? Now, here, you follow me closely a few moments, please. You just strive for the masters. Ephesus had degraded from where they were. You follow me? God has blessed them greatly. And they loved not their lives unto death. I don't care about nothing else. That's that thing up here. I care about absolutely nothing else in life. But the glory of God. And when they did that, they were conquering and the conquering. But after a while, they got a little grace in the soul and a little ooze and ahs because they were doing pretty good in church. You know, most people that you know and have known all of their spiritual growth in about the first 6 months. And you check it. They be fasting and praying and reading and going over their lives and seeing how they might go higher in the Lord. But then after a while, they are accepted. And they are doing it good as the ordinary. But you got to be, the Bible says, you got to strive for the excellence. You excel. You want to excel. Not just exist.
Amen.
Okay, listen. fighting for the masters. You be fighting close. And you check your own life. Check your own life. And see if that same quest is alive that it was initially. You find me. See, you can think too highly of yourself. And you're so carried away with the little progress you've made that you don't sense there's so much room in the top. I mean necessarily room. I mean that you can't do without. You find me. Please. Now, Paul sensed that. And he knew that they were not going anywhere without him. So he laid out how he would come by it. You follow me? Now, strive for the master. Read that again. Let's strive.
And every man that strives for the master.
I mean, you're striving. Listen, you follow this? You're not just going to relax into it or float into it. You're striving in it.
My God.
Wait a minute, sir. Well, now, if you just take that away, what are you doing to strive? Tell me exactly what you're doing. What are you doing more than you are in anything? If you're really striving, what are you doing? How are you striving? Have you extra fast day? Giving up 2 hours early in the morning for your devotion? Giving up the degree area stuff? That question marks?
Help, Lord.
When Israel was striving to please God in a desperate situation, they called the people together. Israel. Wait a minute. We are in a desperate situation. We are in desperation here. We could lose our country at all. Father, listen to now. Let's call people together. Everybody. And search out the camp. Pray. Search out the camp. And everybody who would fail to get in this thing and abandon themselves, put them in death. That's how desperate they were. We got to have a victory here. And we got to have a unified victory. You pray on. But now, there are those that want to, listen, let me tell you something. It's the word of God that offends people and calls them to abandon this gospel. I'm going to tell you something quick. Because you find the let down on the back. Healing, the let down on the fasting, all this kind of stuff. And that's men. Well, I do say you better pray pretty hard. That's why you find so many survivors. So few. So desperately few. What? Because they were that striving. Their initial striving is all right for you. And because you got a little here and they get a little prestige and a little honor here and a little food and all because you're doing good. And somebody pats you on the back. What do you say? Striving for the masters. Striving for the masters. You understand? You listen. That initial zeal, that primary zeal, I'm going to tell you, some people, when they get saved and they're seeking God, they're almost afraid to step on an inch. I'm afraid it might be offensive. I want to be right there scared. But now they can step on you and think nothing about it. Their conscience was so sensitive. I want to be right. I don't mean win an argument, but I want to be right before God. I want to be in a position where I can strive for the master here. I want to maximize this thing here. Wait, let me tell you something of God. You just pray with me for a few moments. All right, now. When an individual have gained the masters, he becomes champion. That means that he has conquered every opponent ever faced him. You pray with me. Now I can conquer it. I don't mean a temporary refrain. I mean with conquer it. You know, children different. Joe Lewis probably predated most of you. I was there while I was a youngster. And he was an avid boxer. In fact, he kept the title longer than anyone there. 12 years, they couldn't find anybody on earth to be in. You follow me? But now, I sort of studies his life and see what it was that gave him such success. And how did he get such a mastery over all the men on the earth? The champion, the champion, the champion. Well, there was every one of you should be striving to be a champion. I said, what do you do?
Amen.
I said, what do you do? I had to read that a little more, if you will.
And every man that striveth for the masters,
that's striving for the masters,
is temperate in all things.
Hello. Help me.
Oh, God, how did we get it? Not in one area. Maybe a little less than you used to. But all things.
My God.
You, let me tell you something. When I read and about Joseph's life and what he did to accomplish this goal, you know what he would do? He would go to his training camp and lock in. And his wife, he wouldn't allow his wife there for maybe for months. And the wife divorced him 3 times. Honey, can I get out of the night? Nothing. We were in a fight over 3 months ago. And she said, divorced him 3 times. But he said, I'm going to be tipped. I'm gonna max out my potential here. But he so disciplined himself that nothing feeds him. Even psychologically, I wouldn't think about it. I would let it in the show.
Right.
Well, God let me in. Honey, listen, I'm trying for the masters here. And I got to be in tip-top condition. I'm trying to overcome every man on earth. I'm trying for the masters, not just to be a part of it. I want you to just read a little bit of that, what I gave you there.
Having the victory. It is possible for one to regularly...
Now, not just be a baseball, not just be have a uniform on.
That's right.
You know, I'm fighting for the championship. How many have you won already? Come on.
It is possible for one to regularly attend all of the religious services.
All of the religious services.
Pray.
Go on.
Sing.
Go on.
Testify.
Testify.
Exhort. Do missionary work.
Go on.
Give. Preach. And even have seasons of shouting and rejoicing, and yet not have the victory.
You can do all that. I'm a part of it. All the church is on fire. Well, no, you're on fire.
Amen.
You know, I go to the church when they go forth. Well, do you go forth?
Glory!
Listen to me, sir. I mean in a real way. I mean, when you call an all-night prayer meeting, basically, you come 2 hours early. And stay until it's over. I mean, before God. I mean, you pray so long, pray that God, you had to shave knees. Pray God. You don't want to hear me. Hey! Amen, amen. I'm going to pull you off of God. You got to hold to it. I'm going to tell you something, God. There are those who had it, and you watch it. You watch that. But now, that's almost always an initiative. But that kind of rigor and discipline is more than they are willing to continue. I make a part of them. Joe Lewis was so involved. That was his whole life. There was nothing in life that gave him more delight than being a champion. He was being with his wife or eating vines and what he could afford, anything he wanted. Nothing could impress him anymore. He refused it. He refused, no, I'm sorry, honey. I read this. Amen. This would get in my bloodstream and kind of assort my activities. You follow me? I don't want that. No, that guy should in it. I'm coming. That's hog lord. take it away. Take it away, please. Oh, God. That's animal fat. Come on. I'm going to tell you this. Everything about it. Those who are striving for the mastery, I wanted to do anything to accomplish my goal. I'm striving for it. And I got to strive against the flesh that insists that I eat this or get this or go here or do this or do that or have this satisfaction. And Martha was a queen. I mean, and I think she was even a singer, in fact, professional, you know. And Joe, we were letting it be just a couple of nights. Ma'am, I'm in training. I'm training for a championship battle. And let me tell you, oh God, I don't need help, sir. I'm listening to you. I'm fasting here. I'm fasting. Well, you should have told me that before we got married. You know, and I can't come near you. Well, I tried to tell you. You know, but you were so involved in your thinking and your anticipation that you ignored it. Well, I'm not troubling the fact. Of course, you had to wait a couple of days. Lord have mercy. Let me show you something. Yeah. You get this. His trainer was lauded because of his ability to bring him to that point of readiness and his physique and all and everything that goes along with it being a champion. Let me tell you something. You mark my lips. The reason why the church went to positive and all will follow it, because somebody don't even know what all the training is all about. Don't you know you can't go there except your teachers? Because you're putting who don't teach something, they can't not bring you up to it.
That's right.
Or run off with something you pray that God, and they're not trusting God for themselves.
Lord have mercy.
And you'll perish. You should not stand here.
That's right.
Because it takes too much to get you there. And they don't have the capability of bringing you there. It's not that themselves.
Amen.
I'm going to tell you something. You better look for your jump. Pray that with God. This is a tremendous thing we're dealing with here.
Amen.
So this is your homecoming, Lord. See that? And even your physical habits can be an order. He said, now, I'm going to train, and I want to get out of the ring. I want to go in swimming, and the pool in the gym. So no, that would tighten your muscles. But you need to be flexible. If you exercise, that'd be right. I'm exercising, that's going to make my muscles expand. But you don't need to expand your muscles. Listen, you need to be strong, but you need to be flexible. Everything I do, you need to teach you. But most of them don't even know how to teach you. They don't know what to do. They don't know how to bring your body. Well, how did I get like that? They don't know, because they never met themselves. I'm going to tell you something. They don't know how to do it. They don't have that capability. And they can't bring you nowhere. And you will die. You'll never reach it. But if there are those who, if you teach them how to do it, there's so much involved, they'll ignore you and turn against you. Oh, that's not necessary. You can be with your wife. When you get professional, women be waiting for you. You're professional basketball player, you find them, and boxers and football or whatever they are. And just for the prestige of being with someone that announced it, and flamboyant and sensational and all that kind of thing. You follow me? Mm-hmm. All right, listen. So, and they say here how he would do it is running. There was a certain amount of running. He would cut wood. He would put that hardens him to an extent, but it would not affect his flexibility. What is it, God? See, this thing I have taught you about this. He won. The particulars. Even John Wesley, every man that I've studied who amount to anything, check his habits. When John Wesley, he would get up at about 20,000 miles a year on horseback. Set up on a horse. And he would not sleep above or beyond 4:30 in the morning. And when he got 85 and his body began to deteriorate, and so he always just wept because he couldn't get up no more at 4:30. You wept because you had to get up one morning at 4:30. I got to give him that time. Start taking around and running the train. And men had a revival, and God was so worthy of him that you cannot sit under his gospel. He talk to a thousand people, maybe without a mic, because of magnified voice.
That's right.
You go preach a sermon to anybody in town, you say. And close the bars and everything else. That discipline, let me go back to my text for a moment. Come on.
And every man that strives for the masses, is temperate in all things.
You're temperate in all things.
My God.
Watch it. Come on with it.
Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown. But we an incorruptible.
Wait a minute. They do all of that just to be the champion, a boxing champion, a high point man, and all this kind of stuff. You follow me? Or make an All-American. But wait, my God, that would condemn us into judgment. When you go, that was too much, Lord, my body would begin to suffer. Well, you did all that just to be a champion to make the team with the University of Michigan, Ohio State, or wherever the case might be, or the Miami Heat, or whomever.
My God.
To be next to Michael Jordan, you did all that just to obtain that? And you can't, and you're stopping. God, you stop it, and doing it, sometimes you don't.
Lord, help us all. Shake us, Lord.
They're condemning the judgment. Right. Who you say, I couldn't do it? Wait a minute. Judas did it. No. All of you got guys who even turned vegetarian, everything, whatever necessary. I like this California fella, who I tell you, his cousin, she never met him. But he was on a apparatus there. And I said, now I saw the guy, he looked like he was a monster almost, with 293 pounds, and about 34 waist, and 23-inch bicep. I said, how in the world? I said, what do you do? He said, I only eat what swim or flies. I went down there, I said, no, and that's the key. And he just did like that. I said, man, what about you? I had to make his pants because his thighs were so muscular. Big, look like a little boy wearing too long short, too short for long. Anyway, and he's down there. I said, Greg, how do you get to that? He said, you squat with 600 pounds. And then they just punch them legs. What I mean, and then the legs start expanding. You know, and what? You want to be Mr. Universe. And they took you to Australia. And he did all that, he would do nothing amiss at all. What that would get that would deter him for a corruptible crown. What are you doing, my God? What sacrifice are you making to be at the top of it? I'm not talking about to contest somebody to be at the top of it. But for strive what? Read.
And every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate in
all things. All things. I'm not going anything that would affect me. Physically at all, that weaken me, I don't care what it is, how legitimate it is, I won't do it. And you can't refrain for Christ's sake? Well, you know what? I've been without a husband for 2 years. 2 years? What about those who've been there for a lifetime? And when you were on the ball team, you wouldn't do it. Because you want to be on the third and five. I'm going to tell you, the Bible speaks about those who are riled up in the judgment and condemn you because they did what you shouldn't be doing. It was available with you. This situation now. You would have to do all that's available. Yeah. Well, how you know? The one talent man was casting out of darkness because he could have been there if he had applied himself. If he had disciplined himself, he could have increased his goods and been commended of his master. But he was I'm going to tell you something. Sit around and smoke to thank God and boast because of what you think you are. And prioritize other things than the kingdom. Praise the Lord God. I'm not talking about no fanaticism. I want to be all that I'm capable of being. I want to be all that God has vouchsafed to me. I want to be that. Now, I tell you what, if a person maintains that attitude, there will be no backsliding.
True.
Mm-hmm. Why? Because he's always reaching for something higher than his spirit. And whatever sacrifice that he has to make to obtain it, I'm ready to do it.
Amen.
That's right, that's right.
And every man that striveth for the mastery,
yes,
is temperate in all,
things.
Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown,
right,
but we an incorruptible.
They have an objective. You ready? Come on with me.
I therefore so run, not as uncertainly, so fight I, not as one that beateth the air.
Listen, come on.
But I keep under my body,
okay,
and bring it into subjection,
my Lord,
lest that by any means, when I preach to others, I myself should
be. I keep it going. Paul said, the Holy Ghost don't take away your natural tendencies. You're going to still have a natural urge for how much Holy Ghost you got.
Right.
Do you understand? What did Paul say?
But I keep under my body.
Oh, I'm finna get some here. I'm finna get some here. I saw the other young man in one of the cities had a beautiful, pretty young lady. And she was paralyzed. Hadn't been married a long time. And I don't know if still living, but maybe live 35, 40 years, never even touch her in a certain fashion anymore. What happened? I went out. What happened? My wife was sick 3 days. I had to have me somebody. Couldn't have anybody. Couldn't have anybody. Couldn't wait to get married. Couldn't wait for the a possible recovery. That's why you got to have control. If that's what I could drop a have to, if necessary, and we ain't gonna be an issue. You follow me? I guess if it proposed a problem, I could stand here after from whatever. Drop the commentator. Running, and he'll be walking through it and taking cold showers 2 times a night. I'm gonna tell you something, children. If you don't do it, that might be your plight, and you lose out with God and lose your soul. Wait, why? Well, I keep on my body. Yes, I got appetite. I have urges. Temptation, everything else. I don't hold it. I'm the captain of the ship. So shut your mouth. And I'm going to squash you down. And I don't want no Jack in the Box. Look, I'm going to tell you something. What Paul said, I keep on my body. Now, we're not talking about the spirit now. In my body. I keep under my body, but otherwise, after I preach to others, oh Lord, if I'm not able to do that, then I'm gonna be a castle and lose myself. I don't care if I am an apostle, I got to deal with that factor of mine. If I don't do that, then I'm lost. If I don't keep my body under control, I'm not talking about my spirit now. I'm my body under control, under absolute control. I'm not gonna be governed by my flesh. Oh Lord. I'm telling you the truth, sir. That's what victory is all about. What champion? How you get there? How do you get there? Come on.
But I keep under my body.
Yes.
And bring it unto subjection.
Bring it under subjection.
Lest by any means.
When I preach to others.
I myself should be a
castaway. I myself should be a cast. I'll be lost. After I preach, I don't care what I preach. I don't care what I've done in the past. But if I can keep this body under absolute control, and when I say shut up, flesh, and that cruelest mouth. You know, listen, well, you can relate this one to yourself. I had a clip, and it might be in STO, where at this girl got married at a flamboyant wedding, and at the reception, they had a little conflict, her husband and her husband, and she took the cake pan and broke his nose at the reception. And the divorce, he just got married. You haven't been home yet. Because you know all the terminology. At the reception, they kept you going. Didn't have to go to no honeymoon. They get sent for honeymoon. And didn't really have honey. Come on. Because you put the nose on. Read.
But I keep under my body.
Yeah.
And bring it into subjection.
Wait a minute, hold it. What was the temptation? I bring my body into subjection. I'm the ruler here. I'm the captain of this ship, not my flesh. Come high, shoes to ask his business. I can't get before God. Well, Lord, my flesh can't come. So you should have been in control. Don't know what somebody that made you do. You should have been in control. Wait just a moment, though. I'll tell you something. But now, there are those who are deceived, and they don't really know when they are in control. Now, we're going to do this. Now, and so we have to stop prematurely. Maybe we will. But now, we want to show you what real championship is all about.
Help.
Come on. Let me read in front of the book.
Webster says that victory is a defeat of an enemy in battle.
All right.
A gain of superiority in war or combat.
All right. Now, back to the book.
But I keep under my
mind. No, the book there. That's it.
Victory.
He gave the best definition of victory and championship that I know. So that's why I want to read verbatim what's written there. Come on.
Webster says that victory is the defeat of an enemy in battle.
Go on.
A gaining of superiority in war or combat. Victory supposes the power of an enemy or an antagonist to prove inferior to that of the victor.
Okay.
Now the three great enemies of the children of men are the world, the flesh, and the devil.
And the devil.
And they are leading the whole human family to eternal ruin.
Come on, here.
But our Savior appeared on the scene and conquered them. And now to everyone who believes on him, he not only delivers from the power of these enemies,
yeah,
but makes them more than conquerors.
Come on, over him. Come on.
Now to make the subject more interesting,
yeah,
let us put it in the form of a question.
Come on.
Have you the victory today? To have victory means that you
If you have the victory, now you're going to go in detail here, please. And I'll check yourself. Come on.
To have victory means that you are on top of everything and have your feet on the neck of every known enemy.
You get mad.
All right.
You can wiggle like one to you. I got you on my feet. Lost. That word fixed up. I got my foot on the neck of everything. Amen. Gossip. A lot of times. Come on with it.
Victory is not a sporadic experience.
Yes. Sporadic.
But one that abides and covers two periods of one's life.
Come on.
The past and the present.
You better be sober and try to perceive this, the past and the present. Let me show you something. Come on.
If you have the victory today, you have, by the grace of God, overcome and conquered every enemy that has ever attacked you.
If you are a champion, then nobody on earth ever bought you that you couldn't put him on the floor.
Put him on the floor.
Count him out. 9, 10. Get your special. He's not getting up. Smell this sauce, not going to happen. Wait a minute, hold it. We're not finished yet. Come on, wait.
If you have the victory today,
yeah,
you have, by the grace of God, overcome and conquered every enemy that has ever attacked you.
That has ever attacked you.
Anywhere along your Christian pathway.
Anywhere what?
along your Christian pathway.
Christian pathway, well, come on with it.
Up to the present moment.
Up to the present moment.
If there is an enemy.
Come on, wait, hold it, Holy Ghost, help us here. What?
If there is an enemy anywhere along your back.
Anywhere along the way.
Who once overcame you and went off with the victory, and you have not pursued him and renewed the fight until you overcame him. You have not the victory today.
Hey, okay, get mad. You made me get mad one time. Well, I was thinking about since I came to San Francisco. You made me get mad. Wake up.
Praise God.
Wake up. I don't need to shout, but you ain't got the victory over me. Wake up. We're going to fight it out. What do you surrender?
Oh!
I'm waking you up, because if I let you, will you have a shot, but you didn't get me? Because you came back close from striking your wife for the day. Intentionally. You follow me? Come on. Listen, I want you to listen. Anything that has ever overthrown you, you got to kill it, wake it up. Wake up, we're not through with this. We're not through with this. We got to fight it. We got to go back in the ring.
Amen.
And we're not going to stop until we drag somebody out.
Thank you.
My God.
You understand? I mean, not only am I doing pretty good now, but I'm going to wake up anything left to me. And if we're going to fight it out until she surrenders. What? Well, how do you know when you got victory? How do you know when you knock him out? Because he's not a threat anymore. I can laugh at him now. I can laugh at old brother out in California. Years ago, he was saved, and he had a problem, and a bullet knocked him down. And he was trying to be saved, and we kind of got himself a big stick in there to him. And he got that dick and whopped with me. And he cried before God. He didn't think he was still in it. He wasn't fighting every day, but he was in it. And it manifested itself. It manifested itself. And so he got before God and walked through at night. That's why God gave him so much vigor I can laugh at it. You will never no more get mad, no more retaliatory spirit. No, nothing. I can laugh at it. I ain't got to go, call it, Lord, help me, I'm not committed adultery. Somebody give me an ice pack and a cold shower, please. You got to do that kind of thing. You got victory.
Amen.
Wait a minute here. If anything along the way had ever overthrown you, praise God, and you ain't made it, it's 5 years, you got to wake it up. But you still feel some urges. I'm not talking about temptation. I mean some sensations. And sometimes almost overwhelm you mentally. You have favorable thoughts about it. I'm trying to show you something for the love of God. You're never going to be a champion without it. Let me tell you something. Joe Louis, just before he was champion, he fought a fellow named Max Milling. I just read it in my source book. I didn't know he was in there. Just a few months ago. And so Smelling, just before he got the championship, knocked him out. And so he was so intent. But now in the meantime, he had a fight and he became a champion. But remember what Smelling did in Germany. Bring him back. I'm going to be champion and bring him back. He defeated me on the way. Come on back, put him in. And say, he did. And now look at that, one round. You're my children. So he hear the word by Smelling no more. He hear the word by Smelling right hand, nothing, no more. We're talking about a real championship this morning. We're not talking about no little spirit or something. We know about so you had a good day. Look on your computer. He probably Max Miller is probably on it right now. I'll tell you what happened. Didn't land around. But he got in the train so hard.
Encourage you, brother.
He was there. And I I remember this. I remember this. Because I was a little boy. And he said, when he got through with him, he was not blowing hard enough to blow out a match. She was in such condition. No. They go, honey. They go home. His wife said, about the rain. They go home. They go to the restaurant. He's not blowing hard enough to blow out a match. He's in such condition now. He had conditioned himself for that victory. He was not blowing all that kind of stuff. Missing beats. Come on now. Now, when Susan, Morasco, who threw you a time, and come by you, your heart missing beats. your breath is inaccurate. The other day, you stagger when you walk. Ain't no victory. That's no real victory. Praise the love of God. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, now, wait just a minute here. And I'm doing pretty good now, but this is the situation. But that thing that threw you is affecting you somehow.
Yes, it is.
You should put that, pause it, put that away. Put them away. I told you the other night about this guy named Lester Felton. He was pretty boxing sort of all. He's so beautiful. He was catching punches, ducking, dodging, missing, all this kind of stuff. But he couldn't put away the point. He'd be maybe out. Then came out and jabbed it, but he didn't have a knockout punch. Some of y'all do pretty good, but you don't have a knockout punch. You hit it sometimes. I went three days fast, and I ain't done it 2 months. You got to get rid of it. You got to put it away.
I
mean, put it away. You got to develop a knockout punch.
You can't
do that by determination. You got to put it away. Well, I'm determined. No, you got to have more than a determination. You got to have more than a determination. Give me a little more please.
If there is an enemy anywhere along your back track who once overcame you and went off with the victory, and you have not pursued him and renewed the fight until you overcame him, you have not the victory today.
You don't have it today.
But he has.
Oh, you don't have it today. Pray that with God. Here you go. Look. Come here, son. Come here, come here, son. Come here, son. Come here, come here. Come here, son. Hey, you ain't got me watching me 4 years ago. And you won the battle. What? You won't fight no more. I face you. Hey, Roscoe. That's you, Roscoe, yeah. Roscoe. You give me a good night kiss and you put your arm around me and let your hand drop. And I dropped. Come on, Rocky. Come on. Walk. You won't get back up no more. I put you away. You gotta put it away, not just touch it. You gotta put it away. Not just kept it pretty and dry and punch and all that kind of stuff. I do this and that. Put them away, you got to put them away. Read the word of God, put your study in the Bible. What do you study? Study it. Don't just read it. Study it. Put it away. Oh, get mad spirit. Amen. I was knighted, even for the first, on the honeymoon, that was wonderful. But after that, I started back fussing again. I've been fussing ever since. And you'll keep on fussing because you don't put it away. Because you still got flesh. You're still easily provoked. And that's a part of you. And you cannot be sweet because you're sour. Bitter. Her bloody wife, be not bitter against her. Be not bitter against them. Well, how do I know that I'm bitter? Because you're not sweet. That's how I know. You're not sweet. You growl still. You're still growling. You know what I mean? Please, oh God. All right, listen. Now, let's conclude this. Turn to Proverbs 4, verse number 12. Come on.
When thou goest, thy steps shall not be straightened.
At Proverbs 4, 12.
Yes, Proverbs 4, 12.
Come on.
When thou goest, thy steps shall not be straightened.
All right.
And when thou runnest, thou shalt not stumble.
Come on.
Take fast hold of it, instruction. Let her not go.
Uh-huh.
Keep her, for she is life.
You tempted everyone. What verse is that? 412, back to 460, what? Read it. Got it there? Okay. Whoever has it, come on with it. You tempted every point that we are yet without sin.
For the word of God is quick,
yeah,
and powerful,
uh-huh,
and sharper than any two-edged
sword. Sharper than any two-edged sword.
Piercing and even dividing asunder,
yeah,
of soul and spirit.
Come on.
And of joints and marrow.
Yeah.
And is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart.
Yeah.
Neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight.
All right.
But all things are naked and open unto the,
yeah,
eyes of him, mm-hmm, with whom we have to do. Seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into heaven.
He was tempted at every point.
For we have not an high priest,
mm-hmm,
which cannot be touched with the feeling, yes, of our infirmity.
All right.
But was in all points tempted, like as we are. Yet,
and this is going to be your final jury, who will determine what is it, depart from me, you wicked, depart. Enter into blessing. That's one of the very one who will tell you that you are. The one who put your excuses on, no, you can't. I went through as a man, I didn't go through as a God. When Jesus went through, he didn't go through as no God. He went through as a man. Otherwise, he couldn't tempt it. God would leave him. So here we are here. So, as you are, and in everything that the devil could find, there was nobody that could, no temptation could affect it. Listen to me. When you're the champion, they searched the world over for 12 years and couldn't find nobody that could feed him. Went down in the South, they got a guy named Arturo Godoy, and all of them going down to the elbow. They're way down here, so they get to Joseph Gatim. That little guy named about 6'7", way to something, Primo Canario, with 22 shoes. You know what I'm saying? They had the shoes downtown. I saw the shoes downtown from Broadway and whatnot. And what Joseph Knight dropped it. Two-time Tony Gunnito, big old guy. And then Joseph wore it out with it. I think that he was hard hit, knocked him down. Julie got back up and used it. Couldn't find nobody. Nobody. Where you been? I've been to Egypt. I'm trying to find somebody to overthrow Tracy. You could have been on Fancy Street. I'm telling you, that there's no way I can walk away from here without sending myself to seek God and get real victory. Otherwise, you're going to fail anyway. But because it's still a part of it in you. There's a residue. I mean, you're going to get mad at the drop of your hat. You know what I mean? Call it upset. We call it what you want to call it. I'm going to tell you the truth. All right. Children. Some people have things that they thought they got rid of and still are alive. They're still there. They're really good. Malice. And they still have malicious intents and all this kind of thing. They're there. You know, and the worrying demon. They're about the worrying of the devil. Their mind is about to be 25 years old. And their mind is almost gone. I remember a problem in my mind. Son, how are you? What? You can't give it to God? What? You can't give it to God? I don't mean problems that's got to be solved, but I don't mean that we're looking for a solution. That's different. See, we all say to God. And now listen. And if they're there, they're not going away. They're not going away. If those residues are there, they're not going away. And you think that time will eradicate it. I'm working on it. When would you start working on it? In 1963, and you're still working on it? Well, I'm afraid that that'll stay. I'm afraid that that'll stay. If you've been working on it 4 or 5 years and all this kind of stuff, I'm still working on it. I'm afraid that that'll stay. And let me show you something. As I indicated earlier, I want you to start 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. Give me verse 8, verse 9. What do you have there?
For now we live,
yes,
if we stand fast in the Lord.
Okay, go on.
For what thanks can we render to God again for you?
Yes.
For all the joy wherewith we joy for your sake before our God.
Go on.
Night and day, praying exceedingly,
yes,
that we might see your face and might perfect that
those people were incomplete. They didn't have full victory. They were not champions. But they had to have a man of God with something to impart to bring them up there. We strove, amen, and gave up all we had for years to bring this congregation out of the mud pile.
Yes.
They had no standards at all for this. What I was saying, people would run the Christian Fellowship, they'll do what they want to do. Father, and all these years, they struggled and brought them where they could trust God.
Yes.
And where they could, the young girl would know how to live celibate, as they say. The young men likewise.
Mm-hmm.
All these children right here, now some of them ran more than they were too young, poor. But now, mess around and get somebody who ain't got the picture, who can't bring you up there. Or they can't bring you up there because what they had been in this 1924, they couldn't bring them up there. So you got to have somebody capable of bringing you to championship. And if they're not champions themselves, they can't bring you.
That's right.
They don't know what it's all about.
That's right.
They don't know how to do it. You mess around and get up some little clip and clean somebody went off with you without God. And all y'all do that for hell. I'm going to tell you something, God. See, it takes some effort and some concentration and some real power to bring people. Listen, we've had people in all kinds of situations. I mean, we meet them on the street, wherever, and we kind of challenge them. We've had people here who were so bound that we had to work all night through the night, talk about in the bathroom, and to get some sisters, sister young boys, can't get some sisters with an anointing, go and work with them. And they were just bound by heroin and all that kind of stuff years ago. And come out with the victory. But people come here from another city that their relatives knew about it. Because I think the people in Jackson, Connecticut, they brought them here. And then their wife came here. And so he wanted to be saved. Devil possessed. And he couldn't be. He could give you those spirits. Which I'm gonna tell you something. When you mess around here, tell my children at all, you mess around too long, and fool around want to give you those spirits, ain't got nobody to live here. You gotta like pretty proud for you. So well, you met the pool dried up. You went to that other pool where you used to get refreshing, but that pool dried up. Ain't nobody not to live here. You got a spirit now you want to get rid of it, but ain't nobody to live here. There's nobody to take a rebuke. Nobody can cast him out. You better get it while you can. Oh, you better get it while you can. I'm ready to be saved now. But I can't stop. I got the key hippies. And then you get some preacher who don't know what it's all about or something saying, I got the key hippies. And he said, I got the hippies too. Okay. Y'all got the hippies too. And I'm going to tell you something, God. You better know what you got something. You know, God. There's somebody who can impart something to you. You know what I mean? We gotta go. Go on. Well, I can't be alone. What? Wait, hold on. Spirit? What do you mean? I'm Legion, so I got plenty of them. Yeah. But whatever that's one of y'all. Paul's with me. You got the imperfection here. You're not a champion. Your faith is not this right. You better pray. Your faith is not right. You're not a champion. You're not a champion. Boy, now we've been praying night and day to come check you out. That you might get your faith right. You might thank somebody. I did not get around here, but she ain't got nobody to pray for you. You went too late. Your champion is gone now. Your trainer is gone. The person who can inspire and encourage you to do it is no more. And now, you come in too late. You should have come when you should have. You should have come when you should
have.
You come here to come when you should have. You should have come when you should have. Where the old faith, the old way, I can really lay hands on me and I get well. Well, you missed out, now they're gone. And now you got somebody to pray for you.
My God.
Oh, God.
You didn't come when you should have. You didn't come when you should have. I'm so glad, thank God. I get up in the morning, I don't know how much time I spend thanking the Lord. Amen. That I didn't wait around a week, and I was impressed by those people who I'm going to tell heaven for. My sisters and my brothers and all these people, oh, they were so sentimental. We're all getting, having to play the little records, doing the little, on the little machines. Some of them made them wind them up 3 years ago. And all them, they were getting all night, called the bell house. They were going years ago. And I said, where are they now? I told my brother yesterday, I said, you know what?
Let me tell you something. You mess around here, and God can get you in the predicament.
sickness and your health. You make my medicine become unresponsive, and you're just 25 years old. And you're at the corner of the day. Mm-hmm. And it's too bad, because that's what you married for, the flesh. And now it's no longer available. It's no longer workful. And now you can't make it because you need the victory. You can't keep your body under. It's cutting up. It's ready to erupt at any time. Like Mount Tabor. You're trembling. That was the man out in Washington. That mountain out there. That volcano. Yeah, Mount Sinai. But anyway, they know when it starts trembling maybe two or three days before. Or two or three days before. Amen. And you have to try to get big and then come in. Oh. Man, I'm about to go up there anyway. Get situated. All right, here we are. Here we are, praise God. Shall we stand?
Help us all.
Oh, here we are. Praise God. Come in.